an honor and a pleasure to have the opportunity to share this day with you. To our distinguished political officials, federal and state level, flag and general officers, members of the armed service, veterans and friends. There's no better place I'd rather be than be standing here with you, honoring our veterans and also honoring our fallen. You, of all people, are acutely aware of what this day means and why it deserves such reverence. This is America in its finest hour, honoring those who have made a sacrifice for the freedoms we enjoy and setting an example for following generations to remember, respect with dignity, the valor and sacrifice of its soldiers. All around our nation and in several foreign lands, specifically in Europe and Asia, cemeteries, the American flag flows in the breeze. These flags mark the spot of courageous patriots who embrace the duty to serve the nation in a time of need. When General Colin Powell was Secretary of State, he was in England at a fairly large conference. He was asked by the Archbishop of Canterbury if our plans for Iraq were just an example of empire building by President George Bush. He answered by saying, over the years, the United States has sent many of its fine young men and women into great peril to fight for freedom beyond its borders. The only amount of land we have asked for in return is enough to bury those who did not return. On this day, we honor those here and abroad who answer the call to defend our nation. Valley Forge, New Providence Island, and the bombardment of Tripoli. From these early beginnings, the legacy of our military began. These were the first battles where men and women fought and set a high standard for us, a standard that has lasted for over 230 years. These engagements were among the first where brave men and women gave their lives for our country. Today, Marines, sailors, soldiers, airmen, Coast Guardmen, men and women died while wearing our uniform will be honored today. I know there's nothing new that you're here today about this great day, this day where we honor those who have given all for our nation. But I'm going to repeat it again, and you've heard it many, many times, and it's worth repeating. This may sound a little trite, but I genuinely value the sight of a citizen returning to America after captivity, watching them kiss our American soil. The sight of thankful refugees, future citizens, who show their appreciation in so many ways, the opportunity to live in America. And they say to themselves, and they say out loud, what a blessing to be born in America, to be born with these inalienable rights of citizenship. You see, sometimes we are unable to see what the repatriated see and what the new arrivals see. In my duties as the commanding general of the recruit depot in the Western Recruiting Region, I have the opportunity to observe these troops. About 2 months ago, I was running in a 3-mile run, the last run that the Marines run before their graduation. After I completed the run, a gentleman came up to me. He said, "General, I was born in the country of Ghana, and I am a naturalized American citizen. After September 11, 2001, I was so upset and moved that I tried to join the Marine Corps, but they told me I was too old. I vowed that one of my sons would serve. The son you ran with today was 12 years old at the time, and today he is now a Marine." Ladies and gentlemen, that is what appreciating this great nation is all about. He went on to say, "He fulfilled my promise to serve." Ladies and gentlemen, the freedoms that we enjoy did not come very cheaply. They came at a cost. A cost in thousands of lives. Families that could have been will never be. Fathers, mothers, uncles, cousins, and friends are no longer among us. They all had a name. They all remembered by someone. They all had a story to tell. And one day a year has been set aside to do just that, to remember them. While I don't like admitting that I understand some of the callousness associated with the American psyche, when it comes to remembering those who gave their lives for our freedom, I confess that I understand some of the thinking. It's hard for some people to correlate their success, their financial status, to the blood and sweat of a rifleman, an airman, or sailor's sacrifice. Never mind that we're beneficiaries in a democracy that has become the model around the world. We live in a country of people, by the people, for the people. Powerful words. We elect our governmental representatives. We hold them accountable. We vote. Our votes count. If born on U.S. soil, we're automatically U.S. citizens, regardless of parental citizenship. We have a choice to worship or not to worship. We can buy a car without waiting years for that car to be delivered. We can disagree publicly with elected officials without fear of death or punishment. In America, a husband and a wife can decide to have children, have as many children as they want, without fear of breaking a law. It doesn't matter who our parents happen to be, rich or poor. Those beginnings don't define our future. America is truly a great land of opportunity, but it didn't happen overnight, and it didn't come without a price. So for one day each year, we ask to pause, just for a few minutes, to reflect on the sacrifices and enjoy the essence of Lee Greenwood's song, God Bless the USA. I'm proud to be an American where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right for me. I'll gladly stand up next to you, and you, and you, and you, and defend her still today, because there ain't no doubt about it, I love this land. God bless the USA. When Abraham Lincoln delivered the Gettysburg Address, he was posed the question that I want to draw to your attention. The combined losses from the battle were over 50,000 Americans killed in action. At an assembly of Union soldiers, local politicians, and an assortment of civilian townfolk, President Lincoln was asked, what can we do that is worthy of their sacrifice? His answer to this very difficult question was that we should rededicate our lives now and for the future to be lived in such a manner that these honored dead should not have died in vain. Carmela LaSpada, executive director of White House Commissions on Remembrance, understood that. While walking across Lafayette Park, she encountered a young school-age group, elementary students, and she asked them, what does Memorial Day mean? And they said, it was when the pool opened. Well, you know, adults, it's not their fault, it's our fault. Because we should tell our young and our children what this day stands for. We should tell our young about Master at Arms Michael Manzur, the Navy SEAL who was awarded the Medal of Honor for risking his life to save his comrades. We should tell them about Mark Allen Lee. We should tell them about General Brooke Krulak, Howland Mann Smith, and Major James Day, and Sergeant Peralta, the Navy Cross winner. You see, each year, tens of thousands of young Americans disregard the imminent danger of two wars and volunteer to defend this nation. It doesn't matter about political disputes. They do it willingly. They swear an oath to support and defend the Constitution regardless of cost. They do this for many reasons. But chief among them is the fact that this generation of Americans has consistently demonstrated the utmost respect for its past and present warriors. Today, we honor a long line of patriots who have honored us by their sacrifice and courage. They all had names, they all have a story to tell, and we should continue to tell that story. So I say to you today, let's rededicate our lives to remember them. God bless the USA. Super Fidelis.